before we go on, but the Boy Scouts were having this raffle for, like, you know, different blankets for sports teams. Like, just, you know, buy your raffle tickets and put the money in the can. Buy, here's the Sharks blanket and the Giants and the Niners and the A's blanket. And I said, oh, I'll just put my tickets in the A's because I'll be the only one. There's no one that's going to go in there. I'll win that raffle. And I told everyone, I'm going to win that raffle. And then nobody called me to win the raffle. I'm like, that's impossible. And I got home the next day and there's a message on my phone. You won the raffle. Okay, I think I'm green, and at some point I'm going to see something that says we're going to start our class, and I'm so very good. Thank you so much. Thanks, guys. Okay, welcome once again here and far to our class, our hybrid class, which is hearing science and hearing testing diagnosis. It's really interesting because I'm teaching the diagnostic part of the class to the real juniors in our program right now, part that you will be having coming up. And so many of the pathologies that we're talking about, the tests that we're using to diagnose them, you know, it just all goes back to what the ear is like. And if we said something like, you know, we're going to talk about what these hair cells do, for example. And if I tell you that the hair cells are damaged by aging or certain kinds of drugs that people use when they're having chemotherapy or from noise exposure, then you can understand why that type of hearing loss we're going to call sensory neural, because it's part of the sensory and neural system. And if you know how the ear works, then you're way better off understanding how we test it and how we look for pathologies. Because let's face it, there are only so many things that can go wrong in the ear, and we'll talk about what all those things are and what people's symptoms are and you know, what our tests are to diagnose their problems, and that'll be the second half of the class coming up. So what I want to do now is take about 10-15 minutes to do like kind of a running review. And you know, to do that, we give you a quiz, like an oral quiz. Nobody be worried about this. I will block off your face on the camera. I'm kidding. You know how they exit, you know, like make it fuzzy or something. I'm teasing. That's if you're like a criminal. And it's not criminal to not know all of the answers. All I did right now is I pulled up the quizzes that I gave the students last year for the class that had to do with the material. And so some of these questions maybe I didn't emphasize as much for you, but let's just go around and see what we can do about answering the questions. Is that okay? So why don't we start in the back with Ariel, because she looks like she's just a little bit more sleepy today. Ariel, are you sleepy today? Oh, are you getting over flu? I'm so sorry. Yeah, that's really good. Very good. Thank you. Well, thanks for coming. So let's start Ariel with like a softball, since we were talking baseball earlier. Okay, so what we're going to do is it's going to be a little bit of outer ear anatomy. And remember, anybody can pass if they can't. This first question has to do with that. So how about in the pinna has like a central rounded part of the pinna. Ariel, do you remember what that part's called? Okay, pass. Okay, and then we're going to go to,
the concha.
Perfect. But don't say me. Say your name to me.
Dylan.
Okay. Dylan. Perfect. Okay. Dylan says it's the concha. Everybody agree with concha? Dylan. Good job. Right. Okay. All right. And then the ear canal. And this is Kyle, right? Kyle. Perfect. Okay. The ear canal has two glands that produce oil and debris and that form earwax. Name those two glands.
The sebaceous
glands.
And the
sebaceous and cerumenous. And why do we care about that word cerumen? Remember, that's the fancy, tell us,
earwax.
Julia. Earwax. It's Julia, right?
Yes.
Julia says it's the fancy term for earwax.
What do audiologists call it when we're going to remove earwax?
Cerumen management.
Cerumen management.
And isn't that, if I may interject.
Please.
As I was reviewing last night, I got a little distracted on YouTube because I wanted to see what earwax irrigation looked like.
Great.
Fascinating.
Wow.
But a little gross.
It's okay, it's totally gross.
Yeah.
Perfect. Okay, so I've seen, you know, all, of course, and been to many continuing education courses on removing wax from people's ears, and it definitely is gross. But, I mean, it's earwax, right? And so if it's really hard, lots of times the doctors will take a pick and they just kind of pick it right out in one, and it'll come out like a ball because it's like shaped like the ear canal a little bit. It's rounding, you know, rounded. And but then other times if it's really flaky, they have to pick and pick and pick and pick, and they don't want to do that, so they'll irrigate it, they'll wash it out. But you have to, kids don't try it at home, remember, because you have to have the right temperature of water. If you have the wrong temperature, if it's cold water, warm water, something like that, it will cause nystagmus. It'll cause people to get dizzy. And I induced nystagmus on my, like, 8-year-old when I was practicing on him one time. And I felt so bad. Oh, because he had car sickness anyway, so he was so dizzy. Oh, it was terrible. So don't, that's one of the, I just don't care for it. But anyway, perfect. Okay, so our next question is going to go to, and let's see, I'm going to say it is Elaine. Why can't I get you guys straight? Okay, what's your name?
Josephine.
Josephine, okay, perfect. I got you, Josephine. Okay, I got you. Josephine's got the glasses on. Okay, that's okay. Just don't take your glasses off. Okay, perfect. Okay, Josephine, I want to know this question. The first resonant peak that occurs because sound passes through the ear canal is at approximately what frequency?
3,000 to 4,000.
Perfect. Around 3,000, 4,000. We calculated it out to be 3,400 hertz because that's like the speed of sound. Is 343 meters. Remember, we did that formula, but that's a great number to know, 3,000 to 4,000 hertz. Sometimes, if you look in a textbook, it will say that the ear canal resonance is a little bit lower. Sometimes they'll tell you it's like 2,700 hertz or something. And the reason that they're using that figure is because they're also including the concha bowl. The concha makes a little bit of resonance too. So if it were just purely ear canal resonance, it would be a little bit higher. When we add the concha bowl in, it's a little bit lower. Tell me.
Oh, and Mario.
Mariam, right. Okay, Mariam, you're supposed to sit over where Angie
Sorry.
Is. Okay, no worries. Okay. That's my trick, you guys. I try, like, I have these, like, names to seats. Okay, so, Mariam, what's the frequency for, that's the first resonant peak in the of the ear canal? Perfect. Okay, Josephine and Mariam, okay. And Mariam,
yes.
Okay.
There's another peak at like 800 to 900. What's the...
No, it's around 10,000. 10,000 hertz, exactly. And I didn't calculate that out for you because there's really no speech sounds that are made at 10,000 hertz. Mm-hmm. So it doesn't really matter to the ear.
Was there something...
For us, for our purposes.
Yeah.
Oh, that's the resonant frequency of the middle ear.
That's what I was on.
That's the middle ear vibrates.
Okay.
The whole middle ear system. Okay, that's different, you guys. A resonant peak is because sound is going through a tube. Okay, hang on, you guys, right? A resonant peak is because sound is going through a tube. It's going to amplify that energy. A resonant frequency is something else. That's the frequency at which an object naturally prefers to vibrate at because of its mass and stiffness. Okay? The middle ear has a mass and a stiffness. And because of that, the middle ear likes to vibrate around 800-900 hertz. Is that okay, you guys?
Perfect.
Okay? Good. Be sure to make that distinction. Perfect. Okay, here's a softball question to, Amy? Amy, all righty. Josephine and Amy. All right. Amy, here's a softball question to you. Amy, the smallest bone in the body is the...
Pinky.
Perfect. Not the incus? No. Okay, perfect. Just kidding. Good job. Malleus, incus, and stapes. Okay. And the next question I'm going to go to Maryam. And that question for Maryam is, the portion of the malleus that can be visualized through the eardrum, what's that part called? Pass, Jennifer.
The manubrium.
The manubrium of the malleus. That's the part that can be visualized through the eardrum. That's great, you guys, because see, you know what? We're going to just look so good when you look at an eardrum. Yes, I see the manubrium and the cone of light and, you know, all of those structures. You know, we're not just look good, but, I mean, we're professionals, and we have to know, oh, what's that I'm looking at, right? We're going to call these things by their anatomical terms, and that's what we're going to do. All right, so let's see. I got Natalie, right? Okay, Natalie, tell me this one. What is a transducer? What does transducer mean? What is that?
It matches the two different impedances.
That's a transformer.
It changes one kind of energy to another.
Perfect. Okay, and what kind of energy do we have that goes into the middle ear?
Air.
We call that acoustical energy, sound waves, acoustic energy. And what kind of energy does the middle ear transduce it to?
Fluid.
There's no fluid in there unless you have an ear infection. What's happening in the middle ear? The eardrum moves, the bones move. When something moves, that something moves is called a kind of energy. Philip, can you help her? Nope.
Mechanical energy.
There we go. Mechanical energy. Okay. All right, you guys, study up. Study up, because if you're not studied up and we get that midterm that we're going to schedule in like 3 weeks, we're going to schedule that today at, like, for March 17th, I think. Is that right? March 17th, we'll have a midterm in here. March 17th, is that a Thursday?
It is.
Because I just scheduled the Tuesday class for March 15th. So can I schedule you for March 17th? Perfect. So the midterm, let me just tell you guys how we do that. This is an undergraduate class. It's going to be a 50-question, multiple-choice, true-false, matching exam. Multiple-choice, true-false, matching. And what I want you to do is to bring a Scantron and a pencil so that I can scan your answers when we're done and post the scores, like, immediately. And which Scantron do you want to get? Do you know over? I didn't bring one at all. I'll bring one next week to show you. Kyle's looking. Kyle, do you have a Scantron?
Is it the 82?
Let's take a look and see what you have. I don't know what this one. Perfect. Perfect. Josephine's got it. Can you, Josephine? And Josephine, did you buy that at the Just Below
bookstore?
Bookstore. And it Just Below has them. It's the narrow green one. But almost anyone will work. If you don't have the narrow green one, I think it still works, but that's the best one. And if you buy, I usually tell the students to buy a six-pack. They come in sixes because I have two tests in one class, two in the next. But since you only have two classes with me, a four-pack will do. Okay? Perfect. Okay, so next question. Okay, we're going to skip over to... Elaine. Okay, perfect. Elaine, you normally sit over there, right? But you're sitting next to Irene today, just to throw me off. Okay, no worries. Okay, I got Josephine, I got Amy, I got Miriam, Jennifer, Natalie, Philip, okay, Dylan, Kyle, Ariel. Okay, I'm on it. Monica, Angie, Tina, Rosie, perfect. All right, I think I got everybody right now. Okay. All right. Elaine. You guys could do me a favor also and put your pictures on, like, the canvas. That would help me too. Did you want to do that? If you want to, that will help. Okay, so Elaine, here's the question for you. The middle ear space has some boundaries. There's a medial boundary, a lateral wall, the upper boundary, and the lower boundary. Would you like to tell me if you think how many of those boundaries you might know? Like the medial boundary, what's that called? That's the lateral boundary, the lateral wall. Medial, more inside, what's that one called? That's where the horizontal semicircular canal makes this bulge into the middle ear space. Promontory, perfect. And how about the upper boundary? What is that called? Gonna go up in the attic? Up in the attic or the epitympanic recess? Is that okay, you guys? The attic? And how about the floor? What's that one? It's bone. Temporal bone. Got it, you guys, the boundaries? Okay, perfect. All right. Now we're going to move over to, that was quiz that, you guys. I can see you need a little review. Yeah, you guys, a lot of you, how we're doing? Could you guys have answered those questions? No, because you weren't ready for a quiz, but you're going to try to get ready. That's, honestly, I'm telling you, that is the absolute best way to study for this. Okay, so now we're going to do a couple more questions, and then we'll get, getting our running start up to our material for today. So, okay, Irene, tell me, the middle ear has its own resonant frequency. We mentioned that. Do you remember what frequency it is? Its own resonant frequency, the frequency the middle ear likes to vibrate at. Irene. Okay, pass. Carney? Yeah, we just talked about it. They were just asking the difference between the resonant peak of the ear canal and the resonant frequency, the frequency at which the middle ear likes to vibrate at. That's the resonant peak of the ear canal. So let's go back and think about this, you guys, because this is a really important concept. And if I didn't emphasize it, we're going to emphasize it now. And that is, everything that has mass and stiffness that likes to vibrate, it has its own resonant frequency. Remember we talked about, like, if you're going around in your car, or the Ella Fitzgerald, la 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 la, she does like the scat singing and it breaks the glass because she's hitting a certain frequency, the resonant frequency of that glass, that it will start moving and it shatters the glass. Do you guys remember that? So the middle ear moves. It's got an eardrum, ossicles, it moves. And that way it acts like a filter because certain frequencies are going to set it in motion easier because it's like around the resonant frequencies of that middle ear. Does that help? What's that resonant frequency of the middle ear? No worries. Angela, do you know?
800 to 900 hertz.
800 to 900 hertz. And you guys, why this is important, it's really important, because I'm going to give you a little teaser here. Let me tease you with this. This is going to be one of the main things that we hit in psychoacoustics, which we are going to hit next week. So I'm going to move on. But I want you guys to look at this. Here's what we're going to do. We're going to take young, normal listeners. Listen, by normal, I mean they haven't worked on the farm with tractors, and they haven't, these are people back in the 1920s, but they replicate this experiment like over and over again. In fact, one of my colleagues is replicating it now. It's really interesting to see if anything's changed. But what we're going to do is we're going to take young people who don't have any ear disease or noise exposure, something like that, and we're going to test their hearing. Because we want to know, what's the softest sound pressure that these young normal ears are going to be able to detect? And while we told you 0.0002 dynes per centimeter squared, okay, but when we told you that number, we didn't tell you that that number might be frequency dependent. In other words, if I ask you, what's the softest sound pressure that you will raise your hand to and say, I hear it? you know what the answer is going to be? It depends. It depends on a lot of things. And one of the things it depends upon is what frequency I'm putting into your ear. Because if I test the octaves between 250 and 8,000 hertz, which is what I'm going to do in a hearing test, 250, 500 is the next octave, 1,000, 2,000, 4,000 hertz, 8,000 hertz. I'm going to test these octaves. And I'm going to find out what's the dB sound pressure level that you can hear at each one of these octaves. And you know what? With a certain kind of headphone that we use, don't care what it's called, with a certain kind of headphone, at 1,000 hertz, we can hear down to 7 dB SPL. That's the softest through this kind of headphones that young, normal adult listeners can hear, 7. But you know what? At 2,000, it has to go up to 9 dB SPL before we hear it. And at 4,000, I don't remember, but it's something like 13 or 15, or I only remember 1,000 and 2,000 because I can't put so many facts in my head. However, I can draw the graph. The graph looks like this. This is called the threshold of audibility curve. Every point on this line is the softest sound that young people can hear. Is it a flat line? No, that means it depends. What's the softest sound you can hear? It depends on what frequency is going into your ear. And I want to ask you, why is it that we can hear softer sounds at 1,000 hertz? Why?
The middle ear,
because the middle ear vibrates the best, earliest, fastest. It gets set into motion around 800,000, 900,000. That's its resonant frequency. This graph is really showing you how the middle ear is a filter. It passes certain frequencies through easier than others, just because of its mass and stiffness. You guys good with that? See that? That's why the resonant frequency of the middle ear is going to matter. Now, I'm going to tease you with one more thing. Can I just tease you? Is this interesting, you guys? Okay. Let me tell you one more interesting thing. You guys tell me, what do you think I'm going to say to people when I test their hearing? And they can hear at all of these numbers that represent the softest sound. Do you think I say, here's my options. Here's my options. Mrs. Nguyen, your hearing is spot on perfect, just like young normal listeners. You can hear 7 dB SPL at 1,000 hertz, this pitch we tested. This higher pitch you could hear at 9. This one you heard at 13. I'm making up 13. You know, that you have, your hearing is at the same numbers as the young normal listeners. That's one thing I could say to them. And heaven knows I'd like to say that to them, because I think in pressure is something that we can measure with an instrument, physically measure with a sound pressure meter. I like to say that to them, but I can't, because that's not how we measure hearing. Hearing is like a behavioral measurement. You have to tell me you hear. And we have taken every one of these numbers and we have made that on a hearing test graph. We're going to give your hearing test to you on a graph. And that graph is going to say frequency up here, 250, 500. This is called an audiogram. Don't write any of this down. This is a teaser, 8K. We're going to test your hearing, and we're going to put it on a graph. And our graph is going to be dB hearing level from 0, which is the number you want to get on your hearing test, down to 110, which is really, really loud. And if somebody can hear at 7 at 1,000 hertz,
we're going to mark a little zero here. Why? Because when I give someone a hearing test and I turn the dial to zero and I give them a tone at 1,000, my dial's turned to zero. Zero doesn't mean there's nothing coming out of there. My audiometer is set up, calibrated, so that when I turn it to zero at 1,000 hertz, 7 dB SPL comes out. And when I make it zero and I test at 2,000 hertz and they hear it zero, you know how much sound pressure is coming out of there in my audiometer when I turn it to 2,000 and I make it be zero? How much is coming out of there in pressure? 9. See that? We have made every one of these numbers called audiometric zero. So now I can say, Mrs. Smith, your hearing is 7 and 9 and 13 and... No. I say, Mrs. Smith, you can hear at zero. Zero is like the softest sounds that young normal people can hear. Your hearing is perfect. Zero, zero, zero. Zero is the number you want to get on your hearing test. It's the soft, we've made all of these numbers on a dial of an audiometer be zero. What do you guys think of that? We'll go back to that. Definitely go back to it. Carney, do you have a question? Sure.
If it's zero at 1,000,
yep.
And like, let's say another patient is at 5 dB.
Yep. Then you know how much pressure they're hearing at 5? 5 is still going to be in the normal range. But if I got 7 coming out at 0, if I give them 10, they hear at 10, that's 17. That's just how much pressure is really coming out of there. But the patients don't need to know that. But I'm letting you know. We're working in sound pressures. We're going to talk about pressure, but when we test hearing, it's a whole different ballgame. Because the hearing tests we're due, we're norming it to what young normal listeners can hear. We've made all of those these pressure values be zero hearing level. So if you're hearing, if you hear at 1,000 hertz and you hear at 60, that's the softest that you hear, great, you have a 60 dB hearing loss. That's how we're going to call it. We never think about this. But what does this really mean if it were really pressure coming out? It's really 67 dB sound pressure. Okay. You guys are looking confused at me, and I just want you to... It's just a teaser. We're going to talk about this. But let me just explain this to you. One more thing to kind of give you a clue. See, when we're talking about hearing testing, we're talking about using a machine that's going to have some dials on it. And when I turn the dial to zero and they can hear it zero, you guys have to get the idea out of your head that zero means nothing. Isn't zero nothing? Zero is not nothing in a hearing test. Zero is each one of these sound pressures, depending upon what frequency it is I'm testing. That's zero on a hearing test. Isn't that interesting, you guys? And when people ask me, what's normal conversational speech? What level am I talking at if I were just talking right here to Julia at a normal conversational level, like 1 meter away, if we were going to have a conversation? What level am I talking at to her? Well, I'm talking to her at 60 dB SPL or 40 dB HL. On the dial of an audiometer, because speech is calibrated in a different way on an audiometer too. So sometimes you'll hear people say normal conversational level is 40 dB. Yeah, it is on an audiometer dial, because 40 doesn't mean 40 pressures coming out. 40 on an audiometer dial means 60 dB of pressure is coming out of there. There's a calibration factor in there. Anyway. We'll go back and hit all of that. Okay, let me just give a couple more questions and then we're done. Okay. How about, what are the structures of the inner ear that are part of the vestibular system? Miriam, can we ask you that? What parts of the inner ear make up the vestibular system?
The Cochlea is in the inner ear, but that's not part of the vestibular system. That's going to be the hearing system. So there's like five things. And Monica wants to take your answer. Is that okay, Miriam? Can I? Okay.
I don't know if I have
vestibular. Okay. What have we got?
Semicircular canal.
That's right. And those are three.
The superior lateral and the medial.
Wow. Pretty good. I didn't ask you even to know that.
The utricle and the
second. Perfect. Wow. Monica's going into vestibular, I see. Okay, perfect. Everybody got the parts of the inner ear that are part of the vestibular system? Perfect. Natalie had reviewed that. Huh, Natalie, you wanted that question. Okay. All right. So what is the fluid in the scala vestibuli and the scala tympani called? Tina, do you remember? Starts with a P.
Paralim?
Yes, paralim. Okay, perfect. And we're going to find out when we test here, when we talk about hearing disorders, that one of the things that could happen to people that causes a sudden hearing loss, where they have to immediately get into the doctor, the sudden hearing loss could be something called due to a paralymphatic fistula. Fistula meaning a little hole. That's where we have fluid leaking out of the round window. Okay? See, paralymph. We have to know where the paralymph is. It's in the scala vestibuli and scala tympani. And what's the fluid that is in the scala media? Do you remember, Tina?
Endolymph.
Perfect. Good job. Excellent. Okay. So the thin shelf of bone projecting out from the medialis, what's that one called? Angie, do you have that one?
It is
osseous spiral lamina, that thin shelf of bone projecting out from the medialis, the inner wall. Perfect. And then stretching across from the osseous spiral lamina to the outer wall, there's a membrane. Rosie, do you remember what that one's called?
Basilar.
Perfect, basilar membrane. And then the name of that rectangular membrane that's up and over to separate out the chambers, what's that one called?
Reisner's
membrane. Got it, everybody? Perfect. Mm-hmm. And let's see. The scala vestibuli and scala tympani communicate with each other up at the apex in an area that's called something that starts with an H. Who remembers that one? Miriam.
The helicotrema.
The helicotrema. However you want to say it. Okay? Perfect. All right, you guys. So study up your notes. That's good because we're going to have a couple weeks that exam, and we're going to need all this information. Every week there's a lot of terminology, so study. Next week I'm going to give you another quiz like this as a way of reviewing that information, okay? Hopefully that will help you guys. All right, so let's talk about where we were. I just want to get a little bit more of a running start up to this particular place. So here's where we were. We talked about sound being a fluctuation in pressure around a null that's propagated through a medium, and now we're talking about the receiver of sound, which is the ear. So this acoustic wave, this changes in condensation, rarefaction, changes in air pressure, those changes are going to strike someone's eardrum, and the eardrum moves. How does the eardrum move? It's complicated, but it moves, okay? In response to changes in pressure. When the eardrum moves, the manubrium of the malleus is embedded in the eardrum, and the ossicles form a tight chain of bone. In fact, did I bring that, you guys, last time? I can't remember if I did from my model. Did I bring that? Did I bring the eardrum model and the ossicular chain? Let's pass that around. Is that okay? This is from a model. There's the eardrum. Can you see the manubrium of the malleus through it? Can you see the long process of the incus through it? And you can see the head of the malleus and the incus up in the attic. Okay, let's pass that around so that you guys, you know, I hate these models look like so 1945 to me or something, but they're probably good hands-on. So it's from a model of the ear that I have in my office. Okay, so ossicles move, We're going to have the stapes foot plate. It's embedded in the oval window in the scala vestibuli. Remember, in pressure differential now. Big pressure in the scala vestibuli. Less pressure on the scala tympani because the round window pops out so that the scala media, and which is the basilar membrane, everything on it, the organ of Corti, everything's going to start moving up and down. The scala media, basilar membrane is going to move up and down. Is that where we are, you guys? And what we said was, where we are right now is we're going to try to find out how does that up and down movement allow the ear to encode what frequencies and at what levels are coming in. Because do you get it? That's how I'm talking. I'm talking speech is rapid changes in frequency, intensity, phase. And my brain has to know what those are. Otherwise, it can't tell there's an S or an F or a T or a P. How are we going to recognize speech, perceive speech, unless we're all lip readers? I mean, and even, you know, if you were deaf, it's very hard to lip read, and for reasons we'll talk about that, but because so few of the sounds are visible on the lips. I mean, it's very difficult. We perceive speech because of what we hear, and the brain has to know what frequency it was. Otherwise, it doesn't know it's a ps or a sh. Okay? How does the brain know that? Somehow, the brain has to get what frequencies and what intensities are coming in. How is it going to do that? It's all going to happen in the inner ear, guys. The inner ear, the auditory nerve. But what's happening is it's in the inner ear. And that's where we're talking right now. How do we take this information, this up and down movement of the basilar membrane, how is it that the ear can encode, can find, put it into a code for the brain? That's what I mean by encode. We're going to tell the brain what frequency and what level it is. How are we going to do that in the cochlea? I'm breaking it down into two ways, right? One is going to be the mechanical part, the movement up and down of the basilar membrane. And the second is going to be how that excites the hair cells. That's going to be like the electrical part, the bioelectrical activity that's going to go on in the inner ear. Is that where we are, you guys? Perfect. Perfect. All right, so that's where I think I said to you guys, this is what's going to happen. And that is that Helmholtz, remember back at Helmholtz, that's where we were. We were at von Beckesche, right? So Helmholtz, back in the 1850s, he says how we know what frequency is coming in is because we've got this membrane in there and it's like a stretch string, and the string gets tighter and looser and tighter and looser, like you were playing a guitar and making the string, you know, shorter and tighter by moving your fingers along the frets of the guitar. The tension of that membrane is what is going to tell the ear what frequency comes in. But von Beckesche disputed that, because von Beckesche built a model. He built like a basilar membrane and Reisner's membrane and the tectorial membrane kind of sliding across the top. He built a model of the basilar membrane. He put it in fluid and he had it anchored in the way that he saw at the osseous spiral lamina, and he had it anchored over on the other side at the spiral ligament. And what he found was that the basilar membrane is not stretched under tension. It's not under tension, meaning it's not like it's a string that's a stretched string where you've got some tension in the sides. What von Beckesche took, he took a probe and he touched his model of the basilar membrane and it just moved. He touched a part and it moved. He touched this part and it moved. He saw that the basilar membrane is moving. So it's not like a stretched string. So if the basilar membrane is moving, how is it that we are knowing what frequency is coming in when we have complex sounds or simple sounds? How do we know it? Well, this is what von Beckesche found. Von Beckesche said that the basilar membrane is going to move in a certain way because the basilar membrane, remember, changes in width and stiffness from the base of the basilar membrane to the apex, and I have just unrolled the basilar membrane for you to show you. It changes in width and stiffness. And you don't have to know it's 0.05, you know, and it's 0.5 millimeters, and it's 100 times stiffer here. I don't care that you know any physical, like, numbers about that. But I do need you to see that the basilar membrane changes in width and in stiffness. It is narrow at the base, and it is stiff at the base, and it is wider at the apex, and it is floppier, less stiff at the apex. This is the analogy that I like to use, you guys, for basilar membrane mechanics. Here's my analogy. When my kids were little, they went to this camp at Mount Hermon down in the Santa Cruz Mountains. And to get from the parking lot to, like, the area where the kids were, like, unloading all their stuff, whatever, dropping their stuff, you had to go over one of these, like, suspension bridge things. Do you know what those things are? They're like these logs that go across this, you know, it's a bridge because down below there's, like, a ravine. There's these logs, and they chain the logs together with some kind of chain, and, like, this bridge is something that you walk on, but it's a little bit shaky. Do you know that kind of bridge I'm talking about? A suspension bridge. And there's all, and this is junior high camp, right? There's always some kid who goes over into the middle, and all the parents are, like, on the bridge, and they're jumping up and down, you know, and the bridge is, like, seeming to be really unstable, and it's like, you know, the kids are screaming, and it's all fun, and it's a suspension bridge. Get it? Now look at this. What if I have this suspension bridge, and I have it be narrow here, and I have it be wider up there? Can I picture that? And now what I'm going to do is, I'm going to take the logs, and I'm going to chain them more tightly together down here so that you can only see, like, a little bit, like, through the logs, because they're pretty close together. There's, like, this chain that's making this part of the bridge stiffer because there's less, like, room to, like, look down. The logs are chained closer together. And as I go further and further and further down the bridge, the logs are, like, spaced a little bit more apart, a little bit more apart. This is simulating the basilar membranes, not a suspension bridge with logs and chains, but it's kind of simulating to you how at the base it's narrow and stiff, and at the apex it's floppier and wider. It's floppier because there's fewer, the logs are less tight, and there's more chain, and there's more give over here. Can you guys see that? And if I incrementally take this and have it narrow and stiff, and I make that wide and floppy, and now what I do is I take the bridge and I shake it. I jump up and down on it at, like, a certain frequency. And the whole bridge is going to be moving up and down, but you know what? There's going to be one spot on that bridge that likes to vibrate at that frequency that I'm shaking it at. Let's suppose I shake the bridge 1,000 times in a second. There's some little area of that bridge that likes to vibrate 1,000 times in a second because of its width and stiffness of that area. So the whole bridge might be going up and down 1,000 times in a second, but that point that likes 1,000 hertz is going up and down more. Because that's its, like, little resonant frequency right there. And if I were to take a picture of what the basilar membrane looks like it's doing when I vibrate it at a certain frequency, remember here it's narrow and stiff? Narrow and stiff things like to vibrate at what? Higher frequencies or lower frequencies? Higher. So if I take this bridge and I shake it at 5,000 times a second, this whole membrane is moving up and down, but part of it moves more. And if I just took a snapshot in time, and I, whoops, it's supposed to be symmetrical, but I never do the bottom thing very good because nobody ever uses the bottom. But what I'm trying to show you is
if I take this basilar membrane and it starts shaking 5,000 times in a second because 5,000 hertz is coming in, down, up, down, up, down, up, 5,000 hertz comes in, this whole basilar membrane is moving, but if I freeze it in time, there's going to be, you can see part of it has is moving up and down more. And most of the time they don't put like the bottom movement on, like they just show it like this. This is a picture that illustrates what is called the traveling wave. The traveling wave of the basilar membrane. They show it like this. And I want you guys right now to never, never, never think that a wave in the cochlea, the traveling wave, has to do with fluid. Like you would think of waves in the ocean. There's fluid moving in the cochlea in a certain way, fluid dynamics. We're not going to talk about it. But because that's not, it's irrelevant to some of the things that I need you to know. When people talk about the traveling wave of the basilar membrane, they're talking about this, the picture of how the membrane itself is waving. Like if I took a flag, don't you guys see like at the baseball games, like at the World Series, that you guys all get my baseball analogy, like they take the flag and then they start waving the flag. And boy, if they don't wave it at the same frequencies, it's a mess, right? But if they start waving a flag, don't you see how a flag is going to look like it's a waving like that, like a motion like that? The traveling wave is the motion of the basilar membrane. And guess what? Bambekashi starts shaking it 5,000 times in a second and he gets this. And then he shakes it 1,000 times in a second and he gets this. And then he shakes it 500 times in a second and he gets this. This right here is called the point of maximum on the basilar membrane. The point of maximum. That means where it moved the most. And he found when he shook it at 5,000, it moved here, and 1,000 here, and 500 hertz, it moved the most here. Do you guys see what's happening? Why did it move the most here? Because of the change in width and stiffness. Narrow, high, stiff systems like to vibrate at high frequencies. Floppier, wider, bigger mass, that likes to vibrate at a lower frequency. And I tell the students, if you just had a good enough microscope, you would see that on the basilar membrane, they have these little labels, 10,000, 1,000, 100, 10, whatever. The basilar membrane is laid out like logarithmically. This area is 10,000, then there's 1,000 hertz, then 100, then 10. Okay, it's more like this. Okay. 10,000, 1,000, 100, you know, something like this, hertz. If you just had a good enough microscope, you could see the labels. I'm kidding. There's no labels. You have to imagine the labels in your mind. Yeah, it says, it really says Prada in there. I'm kidding. No labels. Okay? So if you get this, I want you to show me now what happens on the basilar membrane if I have a signal, and I'm going to draw the spectrum of a signal. I've got a signal that's coming in. A spectrum is plotting what? Frequency as a function of level. Is that right? I've got a certain sound coming in. This is the sound that I've got coming in. Okay? How many tones are in that signal? How many frequencies?
One.
What frequency is it? Because it's a line spectrum, right?
One tone, 1,000 hertz. What level? 20. It's kind of a soft level. Okay? What's the basilar membrane going to look like if I freeze it in time as it's moving so I can get a picture of the traveling wave like frozen in time? What's it going to look like? The traveling wave always starts at the base. It moves towards the apex. It reaches its point of maximum and it damps out. It's going to look like that, peak right at 1,000. Is that right? Now, who can do this one? Now I've got how many tones do I have in that the signal? Is it simple or is it a complex signal? Complex, more than one frequency. How many frequencies do I have in there? And which one is louder? 500. Which one is softest? Okay. Come in. Okay. Okay. Amy. Amy, come on up. You can do it. You can do it, Amy. I know you can do it. Okay? Amy knows that in the cochlea, we're going to perform Fourier analysis. We're going to take a complex sound and it's going to be broken down into its individual sine wave components. Here you go, Amy. You can do it. I'll help you. You know you can do it. That's the signal. See what the basilar membrane is going to look like. It always starts at the base. At the base, moves towards the apex. And you guys see, base doesn't mean bass notes. Bass is stiff and narrow. Bass is high frequency in the cochlea. Love it. Love it. Love it. Wonderful. High five, Amy. What did she do? She did amazing. Could you guys do that? Look at how many points of maximum are there on the basilar membrane? What's the loudest sound that's coming in? 500? What's the softest sound that's coming in? And what sort of other tone is in there, sort of middle level? Do you see? Amy got it immediately, that if it's a louder sound, it's going to move the basilar membrane more, but it's going to stay peaking at 500. And if I have a louder 500 sound coming in, it's going to still look like this. It's still going to peak at 500. It's just going to move it even more. Do you see how frequency is going this way and amplitude is going this way on the basilar membrane? You got it. That's what's going on in the inner ear. And we're not taking a break for a few more minutes, but what I want to show you guys, I'm going to see if I could hook up. I hope I brought the right connector. I'm going to hook up a video of somebody playing da-da-da-da, like on a simulated basilar membrane. And you're going to see how it's going to vibrate in more and less in different frequency, different areas. Because the traveling wave pattern is going to break down any complex sounds into points of maximum along here in terms of frequency this way and amplitude this way. So the inner ear is performing this Fourier analysis. What sounds are coming in? What do you guys think? Can you do that? Can you see that? Anybody have any questions about that, how the inner ear is going to do that? let's just make sure I've covered everything. So basilar membrane, narrow at the base, large meaning wider at the apex. And certain parts of the basilar membrane move more. Point of maximum, sort of laid out logarithmically, and it says uses for, it's just performing Fourier analysis. It's performing Fourier analysis. Thank you, Julia. Okay, so the basilar membrane moves like a wave, a ribbon, or a flag. The base is stiff, responds more to high frequency. Apex, it's wider, floppier. It moves more in response to low frequencies. Do you guys see how we drew it like that? Got it? Okay. And this is an interesting slide. It says cochlear mechanics. How much does the cochlea move? Meaning the basilar membrane. The basilar membrane at threshold, it moves 10 to the minus 12 to 10 to the minus 13th of a centimeter. That is the dimension of the nucleus of an atom. That's all it has to move. And we say, I hear it. That's amazing, isn't that, you guys? So the basilar membrane pattern, the traveling wave, is highly damped. It really should say the traveling wave, not the basilar membrane. Right here, the traveling wave is highly damped, which means it always starts at the base. It moves towards the apex till it reaches its point of maximum, and then it dies out. In that way, it acts really like a filter. You can think that every little spot on the basilar membrane is like its own filter. It likes to vibrate at that frequency and not so much at any others. Okay? Now I want to tell you one more thing, and that is, look, I want to show you one more thing because this may come into play. I don't know if I'm going to talk much about this or not. I haven't decided, but I'm going to show you this just in case it comes into play. If you have a high-frequency sound, any sound that's soft, soft sounds, really just going to move like more of that area at its own frequency. But if you have a loud sound is coming in. Let's say you have a loud 5,000 hertz sound. It's going to start at the base, reach its point of maximum, and die out. If you have a loud 500 hertz sound, so this is 5,000, if you had a good microscope, you'd see, right? Just kidding. Okay. 5,000 hertz, that's the spot that it's its resonant frequency, likes to vibrate at that frequency. If you had a loud 500 hertz sound, look at this, loud 500. Its point of maximum is at 500. It stimulates maximally down here at the apex, but loud high frequencies also stimulate the base. Loud lower frequency sounds have their point of maximum up at the apex. But you can see as they're traveling through, it also stimulates the base. Do I see that? What's the implication of that? Well, I want to tell you something about masking. Don't write this down. I just want you to think about it. If I have a fire alarm go off in here, what frequency is a fire alarm? Low frequency or high frequency? High. Right? It's going to go like that, right? And if it went like that, and I started talking to you, okay, let's line up children and go out the door, single file, leave your backpacks, like whatever I'm telling the kids, right? With a fire alarm going off, right? What if, like at the Giants game, you know, they hit a home run or whatever they do? Sorry. I'm going to say for the record, I love the Giants players. They're wonderful people, okay? But their management will not let my people go to San Jose, meaning the A's. So I'm a little unhappy with the Giants because they keep the A's from moving here. No offense to the Giants, okay? And I know that Dylan is not caring because he likes the Angels and the Cubs. They all have nice stadiums. Never mind. Okay, sorry. If a foghorn goes off, like that big foghorn, and I try to say, children, get your backpacks, whatever, can you see how my voice could be lost in the foghorn? Like, it could not be heard as well as when the, yee, children, get your backpacks, right? You can hear me, like, over that, my voice. But my voice gets more lost in a loud, low frequency coming in. Why? Because loud, low frequencies are taking up the cochlea from me, where I want to be talking in this range. But loud high frequencies only stimulate here, and I've got lots of other frequencies I'm talking at that allow my voice to come through. It's very interesting. We're going to find out in psychoacoustics if I talk about it at all. I'm not sure, but it's called upward spread of masking. Upward spread means low frequencies that are loud spread up and mask these higher frequencies because they're stimulating all of the cochlea. But loud, high frequencies only stimulate there. So there's no spread down to the lower frequencies. They don't mask the other frequencies. You guys get it? Kind of interesting, huh, you guys? Okay. Perfect. That's why when we fit hearing aids to people with big, low-frequency hearing losses, sometimes I take a little bit of that out, low frequency, because there's not that many sounds that are soft, low frequency that are speech sounds because the vowels are low frequency and they're louder. And low frequency is more background noise, humming of the fans and this and that. And it's going to, like, if I amplify that and it spreads up to mask the softer consonant sounds, it doesn't really do the patients that much good. So sometimes I don't mind taking a little bit of that out. But sometimes I add it in because it makes things sound louder. And when they want to have it sound louder, that's why I'm adding it. But most of the fitting formulas for fitting patients with hearing aids, you can see they don't give that much amplification in the low frequencies, mostly because they don't want to take background noise, bring it in, and have that loud, low frequency spread up and mask the consonants. Okay, you guys? Anyway. That's Bacardi. Okay. All right. All right. You guys okay? Can you do this? Can you make a traveling wave? If I ask you on a quiz, like, or an exam, which one of these traveling waves represents, or I might even say, on your test itself, sometimes I have people write on the test. I definitely have people do it on the quiz. There's the spectrum. Draw and label the traveling wave, base and apex. Show me the endpoints, like 10,100, or, you know, show me that it's the high frequencies are at the base and the lower frequencies are at the apex, and then draw like a Fourier, you know, perform Fourier analysis. Take this complex sound and break it down into its individual points of maximum on the basilar membrane. If you guys can do that, you get what's going on in the cochlea as far as the basilar membrane mechanics goes. Is that okay? All right. This is a good stopping place, because now we're going to talk about hair cell physiology. Why don't we take our 10-12 minute break right now,
get to the bathroom, grab something, come back, and then we're going to talk. I'm going to see if I can get my video up going, okay? Take a break, guys. Perfect. Great. We're doing so good.
There's a restaurant across the street.
Back. And you were great. break room that you could come and help me set up something on a computer. You know what? I bet I can just go to the internet and just Google this thing that I just Googled. So.
Stole it and then you
So people are still in the restroom and stuff. No worries. We won't start for a minute or two here, but let's start thinking about getting back. We'll start thinking about getting back to our seats. Sure, what is it?
When we were talking about the boundaries, you know, the lateral wall, the...
Yes.
So that's the boundaries of the
middle ear space. Middle ear space. Okay, you guys, are we all back? Who's... We got Jennifer, we're missing... Amy, okay. All right, Let's get started, you guys. Let's go back to work because I see that they've taken me off of the break time sign. We're going to get back to work. Okay. So I want to just go back and make sure that we're all on the same page. So we're going to go kind of step by step by step by step. They're just like three or four steps just to make sure we all know what we're doing. So you guys remember, like if you have a tuning fork has a certain mass and a certain stiffness. So whenever I strike that tuning fork, it's always going to vibrate at that one frequency. Is that right? We can all agree on that. Things that are stiffer and narrow, they like to vibrate at high frequencies. Things that are floppier and more mass, they like to vibrate at lower frequencies. Can we all agree on that? Got it? Everything that has mass and elasticity has a frequency at which it likes to vibrate at, and it will kind of move more easily and move more at that particular frequency. That's called its resonant frequency, the frequency at which it likes to vibrate. What is the resonant frequency of this table or this pen or my, you know, an eardrum or a, not an eardrum, a drum, okay? If I have a drum and I tighten the membrane and I hit it, it's going to vibrate at a higher frequency than if I unscrew. Like, don't they tune like the timpani drums to like a certain note? How do they tune them? They stretch the membrane tighter if they want a higher note, and they stretch it flop, you know, looser if they want, so it's not under as much tension if they want a lower note. Is that what happens, you guys? We all know that from now acoustics. So you have to picture that inside the ear, in the inner ear, there's a membrane that stretches across, but it's not tight like it would be like if it were a string. It's laying in there, not under tension, but it's got a narrow and stiff part of it at the base of the cochlea. And as it goes up higher and higher, that membrane gets wider and floppier. So if I stimulate the basilar membrane by sending in 4,000 hertz, like that, all of the basilar membrane is going to be moving at 4,000 hertz at times in a second, up and down, because the eardrum is moving 4,000 times and it's going to make the stapes move in and out 4,000 times. The whole basilar membrane will move up and down 4,000 times in a second. But there's one little part of it that's got just the right width and stiffness that it's its own little resonant frequency right at that spot of the basilar membrane. And that part will move more than the other parts. And we're going to find out what's on top of the basilar membrane, the hair cells. If those hair cells get driven up more than the others, right up into this tectorial membrane and the cilia get bent, we're going to find out that's going to stimulate those little hair cells. And those little hair cells are attached to certain neurons, and those neurons are going to start firing, and the ear learns when these neurons fire, it's 4,000. When these neurons over here fire, it's 200. When these, you know, do you guys get it? Each little part of the basilar membrane is like its own little tuning fork, its own little filter. It vibrates at that frequency and doesn't pass along any of the other frequencies. When it gets stimulated, it likes its own frequency to vibrate. Even though it's all moving, parts of it will move more depending upon what frequency is coming in. And how we graphically represent that is just a picture like this. Is that okay, you guys? We okay? Okay. Now I want to show you a couple of demonstrations of that to try to get that even more solidified in our minds. This one is going to be kind of old and grainy and shaky. It's from a lecture that was given in Australia by Graham, blanking on his name, famous auditory neuroscientist, worked on some of the first cochlear implants, and he's going to say that he's going to show you how, you know, how different parts of the basilar membrane are going to vibrate to different frequencies. So let's take a look at his simulation and see what you think about it.
So here we are with a view of the cochlea. The cochlea now uncoils, and we look at the basilar membrane, and now see what happens when we play individual tones.
See down there? See at the
now
base?
A chord. And finally, something really complex. So I kid you not. I mean, this is really what's going on in your ear all the time. It's rather amazing, isn't it? This, for those of you with a mathematical bent, is rather like what's called spectral analysis or Fourier analysis. You break down a waveform into its different sinusoidal components, because each and every waveform that's out there, every sound you can hear, can be described as the sum of a series of sine and cosine waves. And that's exactly what this apparatus does.
This apparatus, our ear. Do you guys want to see that again? It's just like 15 seconds. You want to take a look at that again? Do you see how they've unwrapped the cochlea? They've stretched out the basilar membrane for you. Up there is the base, and down here is the apex, right? You guys saw it's narrow and stiff. So when you put in a note, bing, it's going to stimulate. It's all moving, but this moves it more. Bing, bing, bing. The higher the frequency that comes in, the more the vibration changes to the base where it's stiff and narrow. Can you guys see that? Did you get it? Let's do it one more. It's quick, right? Let's do it one more time. It's fun. And by the way, they're going to show like the eardrum vibrating just for a second, and you kind of see how complex that is. All right. It's complex.
So here we are with a view of the cochlea. The cochlea now uncoils, and we look at the basilar membrane, and now see what happens when we play individual tones. Now a chord. And finally, something really complex. So I kid you not. I mean, this is really what's going on in your ear all the time. It's rather amazing.
You guys okay with that? Mm-hmm. See how that works? I've got one other simulation that I want to show you. And let's see if I can get off of this. And but hopefully, yes. All right. Mm-hmm. Cassandra, it works perfectly. Okay, let's take a look at this for a second. I just Googled, you know, basilar membrane, traveling wave, something like that. You know what, you guys, just Google. Yeah, like, you know, it's really helpful, okay? I want you guys, we're going to play this simulation. Take a look at this. Do you think this is a low frequency or a high frequency? What do you think? This is going to be a low frequency, big spaces between, like a long wavelength, low frequency. So what's going to happen is it's going to change this frequency on the top, and it's going to show you basilar membrane deflection. Here's the base, and here's the apex. So if it's a low frequency, which part of the basilar membrane is going to move the most? Where it's wider and floppier, right? Low frequencies are going to move here at the apex. If it's a higher, becomes higher and higher frequency, where do you think the basilar membrane is going to have its points of maximum? Going what way? Left, down here towards the base. Can you watch it? Look here. This is the frequency coming in. I don't think there's any sound in this demonstration, but let's, I don't think it, you just have to watch frequency and see what happens. Let's start it. Okay. How do I turn, really, how do I turn the frequency down? Oh, here it is. I'm sorry. Here's the volume. Oh, sorry, guys. There was volume. I'm going to turn it down. Don't, it's just annoying. That wasn't loud enough to hurt anyone. Trust me. Okay, I'm going back. Okay. Do you guys see? Did you see what was happening, though? This is getting, I'm going to freeze it a little bit in time. Let's go. As it's getting C to be a higher frequency, see how the it's moving the point of maximum down this way? I'll turn it down a little bit more. Here we go. Even higher frequency, see it's moving its point of maximum this way? And these are just this is just a sweep of tones, right? Just pure tones. They're taking an oscillator, which generates frequency, and just sweeping it from low frequency to high frequency. This isn't even a complex tone. This is like one tone at a time, and it's just showing you how it's moving the point of maximum of the basilar membrane. Parts of it like to vibrate better for high frequencies, the part at the base, and it's showing you that. Got it? All right, I'll turn it down more. You guys. See the frequency? High or low frequency? Where's the vibration? Base or apex? Point of maximum. It's all moving, but this part likes to vibrate at 4,000 hertz or whatever this frequency is, so it moves the most. Okay, guys? That's what's going on in the basilar membrane, in the cochlea. Okay? That's the mechanical part. It's moving up and down.
And when it moves up and down, certain parts of it move more. And now we're going to go to the next exciting part. But let me, and I just Googled this. I just found it. There's probably like a ton of these demonstrations and stuff that are really fun. So if you guys want to amaze your family and friends at what you've learned about cochlear, the cochlea performs Fourier analysis, you can do it. All right, let's go back to this. All right, where was I? This. All right, so where are we? Okay, cochlear mechanics, okay? Okay, perfect. All right, so now that we know that each frequency has its own place on the basilar membrane, see, sometimes this is going to be called like place theory later on of pitch perception. We're saying that each pitch that we hear has a different place on the basilar membrane, the place theory. Now what we need to find out is how that basilar membrane moving up and down actually stimulates the hair cells. And here's where I talk a little bit about neuron physiology. And I want you guys to know that hair cells sort of act as if they were neurons, and they don't exactly act like neurons, but I don't want to talk about what the differences are. But if you think about hair cells acting like neurons, then you won't kind of be wrong. So this is what's going to happen. I talk about it on the slide, but I want you guys to see this. So what's going to happen is, talking about hair cell physiology, let's just make sure that I'm on the same page. Okay. So what happens then is we see that the basilar membrane is moving up and down, and we see that parts of it are going to move more. What's sitting on top of the basilar membrane? Are the pillar cells and some of the supporting cells, but the major cells that we're going to talk about that are responsible for being the sensory receptors for hearing, sensory receptors of a sense means that that's the first place where a stimulus is going to become electrical activity, because the brain reads electricity, right? So a sensory receptor is where the information that has come into the system now becomes bioelectrical or electrical, however you want to think about it. It becomes electrical activity, meaning ions are flowing. And what's the parallel in the visual system? What's the sensory receptor for vision receptors? The rods and cones. The rods and cones. What's the sensory receptor for hearing? It's the hair cells. The hair cells. So sometimes I draw, like I give you guys like a little review of neuron physiology. Let me just kind of just do that now really quickly. You guys can review neuron physiology from your like biology or physiology classes. But okay, I suppose like I'm drawing like a neuron. This is bad. But remember, inside like neurons, they've got chemicals. There's fluid, and they've got chemicals. And inside the fluid, there's more like potassium ions. And outside the fluids outside the neuron, there's more sodium. They're charged differently. So you can see what's going to happen is like the ions in the fluid. These have like a more of a negative charging compared to these ions, right, or charged particles. And the membrane of the hair cell or a neuron serves as an insulator. Remember that, you guys? It keeps these kinds of ions outside the cell. And because you've got different amounts of charges inside and outside, you have the potential for electrical activity, meaning the flow of ions. You have a potential, an electrical potential, but it hasn't reached its potential because the membrane is keeping it insulated. It's keeping it this polarized. The pluses and the minuses apart, polarized. And something's going to happen when neurons get stimulated and when the hair cells get stimulated. It's going to allow the membrane to depolarize.
It no longer serves as an insulator, and therefore the sodium ions rush into the cell. You're going to have this flow of electrical activity. That's what's going on in the hair cells. This is really rudimentary. Do you guys want to read up a little bit, if you want, about neuron physiology? I'm not going to ask you anything about other than that the hair cells act like neurons, where you've got this potential for electricity. Something's going to cause the membrane to depolarize. What's going to cause the hair cell membrane to depolarize? What's going to cause it to allow this ionic exchange, this flow of electricity? Let's take a look at what is going to cause that. Okay. So, here's the basilar membrane, and I'm a hair cell. And I'm lined up on the basilar membrane in my row. And I got my cilia sticking up here. I got my reticular lamina. I got the tectorial membrane laying over the top. And now I'm on my trampoline, I'm moving, and oh, my frequency came in, I'm moving more, okay? And now my cilia get driven up, and what's going to happen is this gelatinous membrane, this tectorial membrane, this goopy gelatinous membrane is double-hinged. Double-hinged meaning that tectorial membrane, remember we said it's attached to the limbus, and it's also attached down at the bottom, like to the osseous spiral lamina. It's like if I had a big notebook. Anybody have like a big binder notebook? And you know how the binder notebook has like this flat part, and then it's got this part, you know, this part, this part that's here, spine. The spine. Thank you. Here's the spine of your notebook, and here's the flat parts going like that. Is that right? See how the spine is... This pretend the flat part going across the top is the tectorial membrane, and it's hinged here at the top and down sort of here at the bottom of the spine. The spine is sort of making like a hinge. So when the basilar membrane is moving up and down, the tectorial membrane, because it's like double hinged, it's sliding across the top. So it doesn't move up and down like that. It slides when the basilar membrane's moving up and down. The tectorial membrane sliding across the top of the cilia, that provides something that they call shear force, shearing action. When you shear something off, right, you kind of cut it at an angle. The tectorial membrane provides this shear force where it's going to bend the cilia of the hair cells. And the cilia of the hair cells are going to bend in a certain way. They're not going to bend like this, back and forth. They're going to bend like this. They're going to bend side to side. So this is the inner wall. This is the outer wall. The cilia are going to get sheared, so they move side to side. Yes?
I'm getting a little bit lost.
Okay.
Which slide are we on, or is this corresponding to a slide?
Let's see. Just probably something about... This was going to be the slide about the hair cell physiology, about the setting up the electrical charge. And then I don't think I have any other slides that are going to address this exactly. So sorry, Julia.
I just thought you might have.
Yeah, is the shearing force up over here? This one. This one. Okay.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. So when we talk about hair cell shear, we say on the slide. We say that the hair cells are sheared in a radial direction. Radial means side to side, not in the cochlea, not lengthwise like this. Is that okay, you guys? Perfect. So let's stop and back up. Let's see where we are. Let's back up and see where we are. So I like to put like some key like points on the slides, but I like everybody to kind of think it through with me. Okay, so I'm sitting on the basilar membrane, I'm a hair cell, and I'm going for a ride. Is that right? I'm moving up and down as the basilar membrane's moving up and down. And sometimes I go on a big wild ride, like Mr. Toad, no, a big wild ride, okay? Because my part moved the most, and I get driven up. And what's on top of me? The tectorial membrane is going to slide across the top of my hair cells pointing up there. It's going to apply this shearing action, which is going to bend my hair cells. That good so far? You guys, you don't have to know this. I don't really know. Okay, let me say this. Here's a couple of details that if you want to have a really, really solid, like hearing science, here's a few miscellaneous details. What we think is that when the basilar membrane moves up, it shears the hair cells in such a way so that they bend toward the outer wall. The outer wall is where the spiral ligament and the stria vascularis are. This is just how I remember it. I remember it this way. I remember that the stria vascularis has all the nutrients and the blood supply to the cochlea. That structure we said had the nutrients and the blood supply. And I like to remember when the hair cells bend towards their blood supply, bend towards the source of their power and their energy. When they're bent that way, and they're bent that way when the basilar membrane moves up, that's the excitatory part. When they're moved up and bent that way, the hair cells are going to excite now in a way I'll show you. That's how I remember it. They bend towards the source of their nutrients. Okay? But the important point is that they're bent with the tectorial membrane sliding across the top. And you can see some good simulations of this on the internet. It will show you, like, it's sort of like the basilar membrane moving up and this other membrane sliding across the top. Amy.
Natalie.
Okay, so Natalie. Perfect.
When the cilia bends up, when the basilar membrane goes up, or it just bends outward?
The cilia are always bending towards the outer wall,
okay,
towards the inner wall. They're
okay,
bending like this. This, 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 this. When they bend this way, towards the outer wall, uh-huh, we think that's what's exciting to them.
Okay.
When do they bend that way? When the basilar membrane moves up.
Okay.
So we think that upward motion is what excites the hair cells. Upward motion, they bend this way. Okay? That's a detail that if you knew that, you would impress anyone. In a trivial bowl. Okay. All I really want you guys to think about is that the cilia are bending in response to this tectorial, this difference in movement between the basilar membrane going up and the tectorial membrane sliding across. That's what I want you to know. When it slides across and the hair cells are bent, it's like it opens little channels in the top of the hair cell. Little channels open up so that this ionic exchange can happen. Now we have the flow of electricity. The hair cells have now given this electrical charge. In other words, I'm going to say it again. When the cilia bend towards the outer wall, little channels open up in the cell membrane. So the cilia go this way. Little channels, see the cilia going this way, this way, this way, this way. Little channels open up. It makes the membrane depolarize, and now we have the flow of ions. That's how we have the electrical activity starting in the hair cells. Okay, you guys? How does that electrical activity excite the nerve fibers? Now we have to know something about the nerve fibers that we haven't talked about before. Where are the nerve fibers? There's an auditory nerve. They've got little extensions into the cochlea.
How do they get in there and where do they go? We need to talk for a few minutes about the auditory nerve fibers. Are we okay with this, you guys? What I have on this slide is the hinge of the tectorial membrane makes it slide across the top and it applies a shear force that depolarizes the membrane so that the cell wall, the membrane is no longer insulating the chemicals and we have this flow of ions. Tina. No, we're not really sure completely about that. It might be that the tectorial membrane is like some of the outer hair cell cilia are embedded in that. It's not completely clear. But it's not moving it until that part moves up the most.
Okay. So it's not excitatory when the cilia is touching the...
Correct. It has to apply the shear force.
Okay.
Bending the cilia is what's going to cause them to essentially fire, if you will. Have this ionic exchange. Okay, so this is the part about the physiology. And I mentioned again to you guys that there are some active processes going on. It's not just that the hair cells are on the trampoline. The hair cells on the trampoline have like a little battery pack, so that they can really elongate and really try to stretch up and touch. Remember that? We said that the hair cells, particularly the outer hair cells, have some structural proteins in them that make them act more like muscle, contractile properties. So that not only are they just on the trampoline passive going up and down, it's like, oh, wait, I'm going up, here, let me give you some extra up. There's some active processes going on in the cochlea. Okay. And did I mention to you guys earlier about the outer hair cells? We think they're responsible for more of the threshold tasks. I think I mentioned that. And the inner hair cells mediate more of the above threshold, the supra threshold tasks. That's what it says on this particular slide. Okay, so review that information. How's that, you guys? Okay. Now we've got to talk about the auditory nerve fibers for a few minutes. Okay, we've got a nerve called the auditory nerve. The auditory nerve, you can think about nerves, you guys. I think about nerves as like a big, the nerve as like a big cable. If I were to dig up in front of my house in the sidewalk or whatever, and I've got my cable company, whatever, I dig up and there's this big cable under there. Is that right? That's like the nerve, this big cable. If I cut open the cable, there's individual wires that are going to individual people's houses. That's like the nerve. The nerve is like a cable, but inside the cable, there are individual nerve fibers. They like wires. They all bundle together as a cable. They even have a sheath around them, the auditory nerve fibers do. But all together, they're individual nerve fibers. Sometimes I call those neurons. Sometimes I call them single units. Do you guys see what I'm talking about? When I talk about an auditory neuron, I'm talking about one of the individual wires in the cable. When I talk about the nerve, I'm talking about the cable as a whole. But individual fibers, wires, I'm going to call a neuron. Sometimes I'm going to call it a nerve fiber or a single unit or this nerve fiber, a neuron, single unit. All of these are the terms that are used in auditory physiology. When they talk about doing a single unit experiment, they mean they're going to take one nerve fiber out of the 18,000 nerve fibers that we have. Okay? So how do these little wires, individual fibers, get up there by the hair cells? Because they're sitting at the base of the hair cells. Here's my hair cell. I've just had an electrical charge, and I got a nerve fiber sitting there at the base.
And when I get an electrical charge, I'm going to secrete some neurotransmitter chemical, right? Some neurotransmitter chemical gets secreted into the synaptic junction. The nerve fibers are synapsing. They're right up there next to, in some fluid, they're synapsing on the hair cells. And when these get stimulated, it's like lighting the match. The neurotransmitter chemical gets secreted and it starts, bing, it gets the neuron now to fire. Okay? How do they get there? So the auditory nerve fibers get into the cochlea through the inner wall, the medialis. Remember we said it was a hollow core of bone? The inner wall, the medialis, a hollow core of bone. The nerve fibers are coming up through the medialis, and they're coming out through little holes in the osseous spiral lamina. Those little holes are called the habenula perforata. Habenula perforata, little perforations in the osseous spiral lamina, so that the nerve fibers are coming in up the inner wall and they're spreading out into all of the turns of the cochlea and synapsing there at the base of the hair cells. I'm going to give you guys this little model to go. This is the all of the nerve fibers running into the cochlea, and if you open it up and take a look at it like this, you'll see that they're like branching out through this inner wall and going to sit on the hair cells. Can I pass this one around to you guys? Angela? How's that, you guys? That's how they get there. Let's talk a little bit about the auditory nerve fibers. Can we do that? Did I mention that there are about 18,000 in humans? In each nerve? The auditory nerve is cranial nerve 8. Can we talk about this? I'm going to skip to the slide. Auditory nerve, cranial nerve 8. Okay? And do you guys know the difference between an afferent and an efferent nerve fiber?
Yes.
Perfect. Is that what your question was, Julia? No.
Oh, no. I was just going to tell you.
But yeah. Oh, yeah. Perfect. That's excellent. You guys know the difference. Okay? Okay, the only thing that I want to tell you guys, there's going to be two things that I want to tell you about the nerve fibers. Two things, maybe three. Okay, so we're going to skip a lot of the auditory nerve fiber physiology. Two things I want to tell you. Okay, one is that almost all of the auditory nerve fibers, like 95% of them, they synapse on the inner hair cells. 95% of the auditory nerve fibers are going to the inner hair cells. What percentage does that leave for the outer hair cells? 5%. What do you guys think this means? If you were drawing up, like architecturally, a system, and you want information from the inner ear, you want to know, and 95% of the information that you collect is coming from the inner hair cells, and 5% of the information you collect is coming from the outer hair cells, what does that tell you? What does that tell you, guys? What do you think? What's more important for the brain to get information about?
Sensory.
The inner hair cells. Put an asterisk on that, because people try to figure out all the time why the ear is organized like that, and nobody really gets why. We don't really know why it's organized like that. But that's how it's organized. 95% of the auditory nerve fibers synapse on the inner hair cells. Okay? Okay? Okay. The second thing that in the slides, it uses some terminology. It says a many-to-one and one-to-many connections. What do you think that should be? Self-explanatory. Whoops. What do you think if this is an inner hair cell and these are the outer hair cells? These are like the rows of them going down the cochlea. If I have auditory nerve fibers, they're coming out the holes in the osseous spiral lamina. I got all these nerve fibers. This one's going to go to this hair cell, and this one, and this one, and this one. And then I got another one that's going to go to here, and to here, and to here, and to here. See how I got many nerve fibers going to one inner, and I got one nerve fiber that's going to stop by a whole bunch of the outers. This is a many-to-one connection, and this is a one-to-many connection. That's what that terminology is in the slide. It's just trying to show you we get more information, more nerve fibers synapsing on the inner hair cells. Nobody knows why, really. Okay? All right. What I want to tell you now is about the auditory nerve. And I'm going to tell you about one experiment that we do with the auditory nerve. Then I'm going to give you a couple facts about the auditory nerve. And then I'm going to tell you the central auditory pathway. And we are done with anatomy and physiology. Just a couple more concepts. Is that okay, you guys? Does everybody feel like you got a handle on? You got the vascular membrane, different parts of it move more. The hair cells are on this trampoline ride. When that part that moves more, it stimulates those hair cells, which stimulates nerve fibers. And now we have to understand a little bit about how the nerve fibers are organized. Are we okay with that, you guys? Mm-hmm. Perfect. Okay. I'm sorry. I do this a little differently than just like walking myself through a slide sometimes. I like to tell you a story and then about what's happening, and then I think that you'll go to the slide to like remind you. The slide doesn't really tell you the story. The slide reminds you of my story. Sorry.
No, that's totally okay. I just like to see where the story's going.
Totally.
First,
and Julia, then, I'm glad that you said that. Yeah, I am absolutely, I know you're completely on it. Okay. And I know that it's good to see where are we. It's perfect. No.
But I like the stories too.
Oh, good. Okay. Perfect. Okay. Well, you have no choice. Okay. Perfect. All right. Let's talk about this. Okay. So I don't know if you guys, I hardly ever tell this, but I'm going to tell you. So when I was in graduate school at Iowa, they told me that I was going to be the research assistant my first semester, and I ended up working in his lab for like 3 years. I was the research assistant for a person named Paul Abbas. You don't care about him. Great guy, though. Paul Abbas is a really wonderful guy. Chair of the department at Iowa for years, not till he was kind of a new guy when I started there, but wonderful man. He's an auditory neuroscientist. He got his PhD in electrical engineering from Johns Hopkins. He went to MIT as an engineer undergrad. He's the one he was my dissertation advisor, and I was doing something in the ear that related eventually to people who wear hearing aids. And I happened to have a hearing aid in my hand one time, and he's like, "What's that in your hand?" I said, "Oh, that's a hearing aid." He's like, "Oh, really? They're so small." This is probably huge back in like 1979 or something. Like, "Oh, that's so small." And it's like, "Yeah, but it's really, it's like, how do they work?" Like, he knows nothing about anything audiology. But of course, that's how people are in these faculties at these programs. They're scientists, like in these areas. And Paul was an auditory neuroscientist, still is. So I was his research assistant for 3 years. And you know what that means? That means that I operated on the animals and ran the experiments in a way he told me to in his lab. So I had to do surgery on cats. Did I tell you that? I try not to say it, but I did. I did surgery on cats, and I love cats, but these cats were not coming back after the surgery. Okay, I'm sorry. They're euthanized. But these are just cats. They're not people's pets. They're like running around the fields in Iowa. They're just like feral cats. People would bring them in to the labs for like, they'd get like $20 a cat. And how else are we going to do science, right? I'm sorry, you guys. But I ran the cat lab. Okay, which is different than being the cat lady. Okay. So what you do in an experiment, sometimes if we did a single unit experiment, you know, we'd sedate the animal, and the animal's like in like a head holder. You sedate the animal, put the head holder, do the surgery, and you would put an electrode on like one of the auditory nerve fibers. The cats have like, instead of a promontory, a bulla. Never mind. Okay, let's just do this. Let's just do our experiment. Come on, do the experiment. Okay, how about if we do the experiment, because we're like a newbie at Iowa. We don't know what we're doing. Let's just put a blindfold on, okay? Because we might as well. We don't know what we're doing. I'm going to put a blindfold on. And now I'm going to open up the auditory. I've opened up the auditory nerve, and I got all these wires in the nerve. I got all these single units. I'm going to put a blindfold on, and I'm going to take my electrode, which is like a little lightning rod, which means if there's any electrical activity, it will go to my lightning rod, and it will show up on a computer monitor that there's electrical activity going on. Like over time, it will show me what's happening. If I take my blindfold, I put it on, I take my electrode, and I stick it in the nerve fiber somewhere, and I capture one individual nerve fiber. I'm going to read from one fiber what's going on. Got it? What am I going to do? I got one nerve fiber. You know what I'm going to do? I'm going to put in all the different frequencies that we use for hearing. And I put in all the different levels. So maybe I start with 250 hertz. I put in a soft sound. And my computer's going to read, we used to do this by hand, my computer's going to read whether there was any electrical activity going off in that one fiber. Then I'll make it louder. Beep, beep, beep. You know, I'll take that one tone, I'll make it louder, louder, and I'll see if anything happened. If that nerve fiber started firing. And then I'm going to take another frequency. Beep, 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 beep. I'll make it louder and see if anything happens. Beep, 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 beep. Another frequency. Make it soft, louder, softer. See if anything happens. Can I do that, you guys? I can do that. See what that one nerve fiber does. And you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to graph it. This is what I'm going to do. Well, what I show you on the slide is this. I show you a couple things on the slide. What I show you on the slide, I took the cap off of this pen and didn't put it back on. Okay, this is like electrical activity, like how many times the nerve fires or it discharges or something about is the nerve reacting or not, as a function of time. And let's say I put in this frequency, some frequency, and it's really soft, and I get this. Okay. This kind of graph tells me that the auditory nerve fiber, whatever one I've captured, because I've just captured one random fiber, at this frequency, at this level, nothing happened, because this constant sort of little electrical activity, that's called spontaneous firing rate. That means, of course, you guys, that all neurons are going to randomly fire once in a while or we're dead. They still fire even if there's nothing stimulating them once in a while, sort of randomly. That's just called their spontaneous firing rate. And you can actually hook up neurons to a loudspeaker. You can take this electrical activity, that's coming from the nerve fiber, plug it into your computer, turn on your speaker, and you'll hear a nerve fiber, and I can never get the sound out of my mind of what it sounds like when it fires, but it's kind of like a splat coming through the speaker. It's like, I can't do it. That's not right, but it's something like that. So if I put in beep to this nerve fiber and it goes just sort of randomly over time, looks like this. Did that nerve fiber react at all to this tone? It didn't. Is that right? Let's put it in louder. See if anything happens. Same frequency, only louder. Right? And now, if this is when it's off, and this is when it goes off, I put in this tone for some period of time, and I see this. Did it react? Mm-hmm. It did. It's out from the floor of the spontaneous activity. I see it reacted. See that? This kind of graph is called a PST histogram, post-stimulus time histogram. Why is it a histogram? Because it really looks like, you know, one of these kinds of graphs like this, right? It's a post-stimulus time histogram. It looks like this. And if we can see that it's reacted from spontaneous rate, we're going to say that, yeah, that neuron fired. If we can just barely see it like this, and you just barely read, I had to read these. No wonder I need glasses. If you can just barely tell that it fired, that's like its threshold. Like it just, whatever this was, just got it going. That's what we're going to call its threshold, right? Threshold is when like it just barely detected it. See how we're going to do that experiment? Now we're going to put in more frequencies. Deep, 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 deep. I'm going to put in all different frequencies and see if that one fiber that I blindfolded myself, I don't know where it's coming from, I captured it, I'm going to put in all the different frequencies at all different levels, I'm going to find where it just reacted, its threshold, where I just saw it react, and now I'm going to take all of that and I'm going to plot it on a graph that's called a tuning curve. What frequencies was that nerve fiber tuned to? It's called a tuning curve. What made that one neuron go? Fire. DB, SPL, as a function of frequency, I captured some neuron and I found that its pattern looked like this. And let's say this is 2,000 hertz. This is just an example. Let's study this graph. What this graph is saying is, for this neuron, I don't know where it is. I just picked it out of the bundle. For this neuron, if I put in 2,000 hertz, I could put it in a really low level, and it started firing. And if I put in 1,000 hertz at a pretty loud level, it started firing too. And if I put in 4,000 hertz, I don't care how loud it was, it never reacted. That's what the graph is telling me about this fiber. Now, folks, here's the great part of this. where do you think that nerve fiber is coming out from the medialis? And where do you think that's sitting in the cochlea by the basilar membrane? Where do you think that fiber is sitting? By which hair cells? Look at this. Here's 10,000. You had your microscope. Here's 1,000. Here's 100. Here's 10 hairs, something like that. I picked out a nerve fiber. It's sitting right under synapsing at some hair cell, along running along the basilar membrane. Take a guess. Where do you think it's sitting if only a small amount of sound pressure at 2,000 made it go off? If the nerve fiber was sitting here and it had to move, the basilar membrane had to move this much to make that hair cell go up and make that nerve fiber go off, and I put in a soft sound so it just moved that spot, would that nerve fiber, if it were sitting right there, would that go off? Because it did. I mean, if it were really from here, does that make sense to you guys? See, the pressure, the frequency at which the lowest sound pressure will stimulate a nerve fiber, that's called the characteristic frequency of that nerve fiber's tuning curve. It's characteristic frequency. It's CF. That stands for characteristic frequency. This nerve fiber, we're going to see, this one is tuned to 2,000. It's its characteristic frequency. Because when I put in a small amount of pressure at 2,000, it will start firing. If I have to move the basilar membrane this much before it fires, a soft pressure at 2,000 moves it that much, it fires. Now look at this. Will it fire to soft pressures at 1,000? Did it do anything in there? No, because every one of these points is its threshold where it just started firing. But it will fire to 1,000 if I make it what? Loud. Look here. Soft at 1,000. Did that spot move? Did this part of the basilar membrane move up here? So soft 1,000 hertz sounds won't make it go. How about a loud 1,000 hertz sound? Did that make this part go up by that much? Yeah. It did. And that's why it fired. Because that nerve fiber's coming from here, guys. And if louder, lower frequencies come in, remember? Loud, low frequencies stimulate more of the apex maximally, but also the base. So I've got this tail on the tuning curve representing louder, lower frequencies will still make this nerve fiber stimulated. But how about at 4,000 hertz? Did that spot move? No, because loud low frequencies stimulate the base. They're highly damped, they go off, and that doesn't get stimulated. And that's what this is showing you. We've got a steeper high frequency like tail. Not a tail, a steeper high frequency
head.
Whatever, slope. Here's the point. The point is that when we study the nerve fibers, we're seeing that they are preserving this kind of same frequency analysis filtering that goes on in the cochlea. The nerve fibers carrying that information. It's going to take it up to the brain. This fiber says, I like 2,000 soft. I'm the 2,000 hertz guy. But if you make 1,000 really loud, I'm going to go off too. And if you make 4,000 really loud, I don't care. Just like that spot on the basilar membrane. It's preserving the analysis that's going on in the cochlea. That's the main point. But the second main point is this. Is that interesting, you guys? See how the nerve fibers are preserving what's happening in the cochlea? It's telling that it's going to be able to tell the brain what's going on because it's going to have the same like information on the nerve. The second thing is that if I take my blindfold off and now I put my electrode on the outside of the auditory nerve, I'm going to get tuning curves that look like this. If I put it along the outside, I get these guys. And if I take my electrode and I put it more in the center of the cable, I get more like these guys. And what I want you to understand is that the auditory nerve is called tonotopic. This is important. The auditory nerve, as well as the whole auditory nervous system, is tonotopic. What does that mean? Tone topic means place, like a topographical map. Tones are at certain places in the auditory system. Frequencies go to certain places. In the auditory nerve, high frequencies go on the outside of the nerve. Lower frequencies go more in the center of the nerve. Frequencies go to a place, and that is preserved all the way up even into the cortex. There is a 1,000 hertz region of your cortex. There is a 2,000 hertz spot. There is a 4,000 hertz. I mean, frequencies go to place. And now I want to ask you this. This is a question that an ear, nose, and throat resident asked me while we were observing a surgery to remove a brain tumor on someone's auditory nerve. There's a benign tumor, we'll learn about it in the second half of the class, that can grow on someone's auditory nerve. An ear, nose, and throat resident said to me, I'm really puzzled. I don't get it. Is it just a coincidence? Why is it that people who have this tumor on their auditory nerve show a high frequency hearing loss in that ear? I started laughing. I did. You're testing me, right? You're kidding me. No. Because they didn't know that the auditory nerve fiber is tonotopic. The high frequencies are on the outside. If the tumor is pressing on the outside, it's disrupting high frequency information. It's going to give you a high frequency hearing loss. Because the auditory nerve is tonotopic. And that's what we can learn also from putting our electrodes in the auditory nerve fibers and looking where we're putting them and finding what the tuning curves are and finding what the characteristic frequencies are of the tuning of the neurons on the outside and the neurons on the inside, and we can see that it's tonotopic. You guys okay with that concept? This goes all the way up the system.
You said that higher frequencies occur along the outside of the nerve?
Correct. High frequencies, here's the nerve. Here's the big cable. All the individual wires are inside running down the cable. Towards the outside, all these fibers around in here, these fibers are coming from the base of the cochlea. They're high, responding, they're organized to code high frequencies. They give us the high, they tell the brain that was a high frequency when this is stimulated. And more insight. So this might be the 8,000 hertz spot. Maybe here's the
250 hairs, kind of fibers. They're all kind of bundled inside, like together, coming from the different regions and turns of the cochlea. Tonotopic. Frequencies go to a place. Okay? Okay, there was one more thing I wanted to say, but okay, perfect. Look at my slides. Does it show it?
Yeah.
Does it show the characteristic frequency and that the nerve fibers are tonotopic? Yes. Got it? Take a look at those slides. Okay. I got to tell you one more thing about the auditory nerve, and then I'm going to ask you about a cochlear implant. Let me tell you one more thing about the auditory nerve. Okay, remember I told you how the auditory nerve fibers, you can hear them on the speaker? You turn on the electrical activity on the speaker? So let's look at this. You tell me if this nerve fiber responds. Okay, I'm going to have Philip. Philip, when I go like this, can you sing just any note for me? Just sing any note, okay? You're so good, Philip. Thank you so much. When I point at you, okay? I'm the auditory nerve fiber. I'm minding my own business. Spontaneous firing rate. Did I respond?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Did I go when he sang? Did I go did sort of arrhythmically? What did I do? Did. You know what the nerve fibers do? Besides firing, I got rhythm. I got music. I got you, girl. Who could ask for anything more? Get it? It's firing locked into the phase, the cycle, the period. It's firing locked into the period of the tone that it's coding, the tone that it's responding to. It doesn't just randomly fire. Which one of these is a higher frequency? Or okay? Get it? Second one's higher frequency. Because it's firing along with the period, along with the phase. Philip.
So is this kind of similar to how analog to digital conversion happens?
That's a very good question and a good point. And yes. But here's what I want you to know. How do the auditory nerve fibers tell the brain what frequency is coming in? The first thing is which fibers are firing. That's the place that they are on the nerve. Because the brain knows these fibers fire. When mommy talks, hi, baby, hi, my little baby, these fibers on the outside are firing. Daddy comes in, hello, baby, hello, my little baby. Baby, say mama, say dada. These fibers are firing. The brain learns that these fibers that fire mean it's a high frequency. These fibers that fire mean it's this frequency, it's that frequency. The brain learns that. It's tonotopically set up. And we learn that. It's got place information to tell us what frequency is coming in. Which fibers fire? Where are they? But what else does the brain get for telling it what frequency is coming in? It gets the periodic firing rate. If something fires 1,000 times in a second, the brain can figure out that's 1,000 hertz coming in. If the nerve fiber fires 2,000 times in a second, that's 2,000. Do you see the brain has two things to look at to tell it what frequency it's coming in? Where and how, what the rhythmic, periodic firing rate is. It converts that period of firing to frequency. And now in like the 2 minutes that I have left for class, 4 minutes, I want to ask you something. What if you're born deaf and you're kind of wired up with the nerve fibers to go to the brain, but the cochlea is not working? Hair cells, they're out. But we have the nerve sitting there wanting to be stimulated, but the hair cells, they're messed up, boy. Now I'm going to take and I'm going to thread some electrodes that are going to pass electricity. And I'm going to thread it through the scala tympani, through like right by the round window opening. I'm going to thread it through and I'm going to swing it all around the medialis so that I can spread electricity all throughout the cochlea. Not perfectly, because there's fluid in there. And electrical activity spreads in the fluid, right? Don't we see in the movies the bad guys in the swimming pool, the heroine throws like an electrical thing in and it, you know, electrocutes because it's like all, you know, I'm sorry, but okay, bad example. I should think of a better example, but right? Electricity is going to spread in fluid. It can't be perfect. But hey, you're deaf. You can't use that ear. What are we going to give you? I mean, we're going to give you enough that deaf kids can sound absolutely like you or me. So it must be enough, right? We'll hear them talking in, you know, in next class when we talk about oral rehab. I spread that electricity through the cochlea with my cochlear implant. So the cochlear implant has a microphone. It's going to pick up sound. And do you think if it picks up a it's going to tell, like, the inner part, the receiver and the electrical, the electrode, if there's a that comes in, where do you think it wants to pass the electricity? The base or the apex?
The base.
That's how it works. That's how a cochlear implant works. The computer separates out all the sounds and it passes electricity to the right spots in the cochlea. Because those nerve fibers are tonotopic, you're going to learn that this nerve fiber just fired. I stimulated it with electricity. It was artificial. No hair cells stimulated it. But I got to it by passing the electricity down to that nerve. And now the baby learns, just like you guys with normal hair cells. How else do you think we might tell the brain that the ah is coming in versus an e versus an oo? Those are complex signals. What do you think happens? Do we pass electricity to various parts of the cochlea that represent those spectral? That's what we do. What else could we do to the electrical activity, to the electrical stimulation? What else can we do to tell the brain what frequency is coming in? How does the normal ear do it? And okay, can we pass that electrical pulse periodically? We can. See how we can do it? It's interesting, cochlear implant patients can't use periodic information the way normal ears do, but don't mind about that. What I'm trying to get you guys to see is we have to know how the ear works so we can figure out a plan of how to get that stimulation to the system that's already wired to get information to the brain.
how are we going to stimulate those nerve fibers as if they were, the hair cells were doing it? Can we do it with this passing electricity around the turns of the cochlea? We can and we do. And we can do it in such a great way that we get these amazing results. And do you see why for adults who've been deaf their whole life, they don't have any neural connection really that's ever been used from ear to the brain? It's like they've been living in the proverbial hearing loss cave. I mean, they don't have stimulation their whole life. So starting to stimulate these nerve fibers just doesn't have any neural meaning. That's why if you're a kid and you don't get hearing aids and you don't use your hearing for 3 or 4 years and now you want a cochlear implant at age 4, you've been signing, you don't have, they won't do it. It's an optional surgery. The insurance companies don't have to do it, and they won't. The surgeons won't do it because it's too late. Now, I'm not saying if a child loses their hearing at age 7 and they've had hearing, they're the perfect candidate, right? They've got it all set up. But I'm just telling you guys, this is how the brain is organized around sound. And this is how we try to go in and fix it, if you will. I know some people don't like the idea of deafness as being a medical problem that can be fixed. And I get that it wasn't for a long time, but now it is. And you can't really kind of stop progress, right? Carney.
What's the optimal time to get those kind of surgeries for a child?
In Europe, they do it 9 months. They'll do it at 9 months here, too. But it's supposed to be a year. But they'll do it at 9 months. Sooner the better. You guys okay? So far, so good? All right. I said we'd finish this up today. We're almost done. Next week, bring your psychoacoustic slides. We're going to spend like 2 weeks max on psychoacoustics. And then we'll have our midterm. There we go. 2 more weeks psychoacoustics. Then we'll have the midterm. Then we'll start the second half of the class, diagnostic audiology. Have a good week, you guys. Thanks for hanging in there. A little bit over. Thanks, you guys. All done, Cassandra. Thank you. Perfect. Isn't this fun? I just love this class.